Oh, there you are. Okay, we're good now. Welcome to Oak Meadow United Methodist Church, the little church with the big heart. We are glad you are all here today. Thank God for the rain. I have some announcements for you today, and I'm probably going to mess them up. There's new inserts for the church directory that everybody can take a copy home after church day. Get us caught up with all our new members. The altar flowers today are in honor of Don Griner's birthday, which was yesterday, and in memory of Setha Thomas's birthday, which is today. Also birthdays this week are Linda Carter, which is today, Craig Hart on Thursday, and Henry Guevara on Friday. Are there any other birthdays than what I've announced? I do not have any anniversaries listed. Is there some we should remember today? Okay, then I will move on toward announcements. Oak Meadow United Methodist t-shirts have been ordered and are scheduled to arrive next week. There will be a United Methodist Men meeting next Saturday, 9 a.m. at Las Chiladas. And my lovely wife, Ricky Ford, has an announcement.
Good morning. I want to let you know that the craft show is coming up on July 27th, which is in 2 weeks. We have had a tremendous response, and it's going to be twice as big as it was last year. I mean, I've sold 20 tables, and we do have a bake sale, so we're asking people to bring baked goods, please. We will have a food truck and activities out front, and I think Casey's going to talk about the activities out front. So please mark your calendars and be sure and come and support this, because we've just had a great response.
Casey?
Good morning, good morning. For those that watching from home, I'm Casey Severs. In case you don't know me, I'm the committee chairman for evangelism. On the 27th, we're having our annual arts and craft fair, as Ricky just mentioned. This year, we're doing something a little bit different. We're going to have some things for the kiddos that the parents may bring with them. So when they go in, they have something to do. We've got a little duck pond. We've got some other games for them to play. We'll have some other things just for them to keep them busy. One of the things that we don't really know is how many people we might have. So that's always a big issue. So we do have a few people that are going to be helping with me, or helping me outside that are with part of the committee. If you are someone that would like to participate in that, we would love to have you. We'll be outside Sunday, or no, the 27th, that's Saturday, I believe. That's Saturday morning, around 9 o'clock or so. There's a certification that we have to have, so many people have. It's called Safe Gathering. If any of you have that and would like to come help us out for a couple hours that morning, we'd really appreciate that as well. I personally don't have it. There are a few that do, and we'll be there. But for so many kids, you have to have a safe gathering certification person that fills that need. So we'd love to see you. I think we're going to have a really good time. And again, if you just get with me, or I'm going to try to do this every Sunday between now and then to keep everybody apprised of it. I know we all forget things, so I appreciate it. Thank you.
Are there any other announcements? Wow. I'm sorry. Oh.
I just had a question. Those inserts for the directory, where do we pick them up?
Out there, I'm assuming, somewhere.
Okay.
Or else I just made it all up. I don't know. Our communion rail offering today will go towards UMCOR's relief for the victims of Hurricane Beryl, which came through Houston. All three sons of mine have been suffering with no electricity for a while, and I think things are starting to get back to normal, but this is a good thing for us to do. Is there anything else I need to remember? Well, then let us prepare our hearts for worship as the choir does the introit. The call to worship is taken from Psalm 24, verses 7 through 10. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. Our hymn of praise is number 98. Please stand if you are able.
Thank you. seated.
Good morning. Thank you for sharing a seat. I kind of stole that extra chair with that bag. What does this look like?
A bag. When do you use little bags like this?
Whenever you need to carry stuff,
right? So if I'm going on a trip or going on vacation, I have to think really hard about all the things I'm going to pack, especially as I get older, because I don't always remember everything. So I brought my bag this morning because the most important thing, what are these? Charging cables, right? I have to have a charger for my phone. I have to have a charger for my watch. I have to have a charger for my headphones. I've got so many chargers, it's crazy, right? And then I have my fuzzy socks because I like to have warm feet when I'm on vacation and I'm in a strange place, right? I got my pajamas. I've got all kinds of things. Oh, I use a CPAP machine, so I have that and all the cables and cords and charger for that. And then I've got clothes, right? So I've got my shorts, I've got a shirt. Oh, but what if I'm going to the beach? What else do I need?
Some
swimming clothes, right? A bathing suit, a towel, a hat,
sunscreen.
Oh, you're right. There's so many things to remember when you're going. What else?
Bug spray.
Oh, that's really important, right? Especially if you're going anywhere near Houston right now with all the rain. The mosquitoes are awful. Well, there's a lot of things to remember when we're going on a trip, aren't there? Do you do your own packing or do your parents pack for you when you go?
You
do your own packing? Good job taking responsibility for that. Well, oh, and you know what? I even have things stuffed in my side pocket. I got my medicine here. I've got all kinds of stuff. That's really important, right? Well, in today's scripture story, Jesus and his disciples are together, and he gets ready to send them on a journey. But he gives them some special instructions. He tells them, only take with you a staff. That's like a walking stick, right? He tells them, no extra clothes, no money, no food. They're just going to take off. What do you think is going to happen? You think they're going to run out of stuff? I would think so, too. Do you think maybe they're a little nervous about going on a trip with no supplies and no suitcase, no backpack, no nothing? I would be nervous, too, right? But Jesus tells them that he is giving them the power. He's giving them the authority that they need to go out and to heal people, to cast out evil in the world, and that they're going to be taken care of when they travel. Did they have to have faith in him to take out on that journey with just their staff, their walking stick? Yeah, I'd be a little nervous, right? I'd be like, I'm not quite sure if I'm ready for that, right? So they went with no money, no food, no extra clothes. And they found that people would welcome them along the way. They fed them, they gave them a place to stay, and they were able to heal people, cast out evil spirits, spread the word of the Lord on their trips because they did exactly what Jesus told them to do. They had faith in what he had told them, and they went forward. Well, Jesus also told you and I to go out and make disciples, right? And sometimes I wonder if we kind of delay doing that or we're a little hesitant to do it because we think, oh, I'm not prepared, I'm not ready, I don't have the right bag packed, I don't have the equipment I need, I don't have all the Bible knowledge that maybe I should have, right? But does Jesus tell us to prepare with all that first? No. We're ready. We just have to listen to the call of the Lord and spread the good news to other people. So get ready to be on your life journey and bring other people to church, tell them about Christ, and don't worry about whether your bag has absolutely everything that you need to have. You don't have to be a Bible scholar. You just have to be a believer in Jesus and be willing to spread that good news to others. Okay? This is a repeat after me. Father, We know that many people need to hear the good news. Jesus has told us to go and make disciples. Help us be willing to go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Join me now in our opening prayer. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known. From you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now for the prayer of illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our epistle lesson comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. Now hear these words. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with the pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given to us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace, that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will according to the good pleasure which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we are also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Now, as a community of believers, we come together with our affirmation of faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we look at our prayers this morning, we see those listed there on the back of the bulletin. And it's certainly good to see David and Amy here again today with your family and all that are here. Notice the others that are listed there. Of course, Barbara Beard there in the back. We're glad that you're back, Barbara. Robert and I weren't here last Sunday, so we missed a lot. But we're glad we're back, and everything went so well last Sunday. We're very appreciative of that, how George and Terry had the service last Sunday. And Tom and Linda, grandparents for Thomas and little Hannah, and Dawn, the wife. God bless y'all. It's wonderful to have. I don't know if you've seen the pictures yet, but she is perfect. Little Hannah is perfect. And Nancy Pierce had a very successful operation. She said she wouldn't be here today, but we're glad that Nancy Pierce is doing well. And that we have a new bishop, Cynthia Fierro Harvey, and her husband. We're very pleased that she is our new bishop. Now, notice the concerns, of course, some of you, many of all of us have a concern from last night, from the shooting of Donald Trump. And we pray that he does well, whatever party you're part of. Also, we want to be in prayer for Logan Sides. We've been praying for him before. And his leukemia's come back, right? So we want to keep Logan Sides in our prayers. Verna Sorensen is a friend of ours in water aerobics. She had a grapefruit-sized tumor removed from her head and very much needs our prayers for Verna Sorensen. And for Robert Dolby, who's finished his surgery, we want to keep Robert in our prayers for sure. And for Naomi Guevara, how's Naomi doing? With a surgeon. Okay, so we're going to keep Naomi Guevara in our prayers and these other new ones that we have listed here. Certainly been in prayer for Linda Clark. Want to continue that. And for Bob Garcia, we want to continue to keep Bob in our prayers. And Eric and Claudia Wade, some of us men who have Emmaus on Saturday morning. Eric Wade is one of the members. He's at University Hospital, and his wife Claudia has been taking care of him. And of course, the Schoenert's grandson, Avery, who was flooded there in Houston. We want to keep Avery, your grandson, in our prayers. And of course, all of those who have been a part of the aftermath of the Hurricane Beryl, and you have seen your opportunity when you come for communion to leave an offering through UMCOR for those who are suffering. What other joys or concerns do we have this morning? Yes, please.
We have the joy to have our godson with us for a little bit of time here in Texas from Virginia.
From Virginia. Glad you're here from Virginia. Godson. Yes, Richard. So we need to pray for John and Marion Hendricks, especially Marion is not doing well for the Hendricks. Who else do we need to pray for? So, oh, yes.
My mom, she had a bad fall and she's got a big lump on her head and she's still having massive headaches.
Oh, bless her heart. For Lois Danforth, had a fall. We talked on the phone and she wouldn't go to the hospital. She is stubborn. But has a bump on her head, bless her heart. Yes, Terry.
We got to have a visit Wednesday with our grandson from Alabama and grandsons, and it was really nice to see that family, and they're traveling back to Alabama today, so prayers for them.
Oh, prayers for safe travel back to Alabama. Yes, others. Yes.
Carla, I understand that she's going to have surgery.
No, I don't know about surgery. She's seeing a doctor about her rotator cuff.
Oh, Carla's going to see a doctor about her rotator cuff, so we want to keep Carla Waller in our prayers. Thank you. Other joys or concerns? David.
My good friend from high school, he's also the best man at our wedding, just stood for me this morning. He has colon cancer, and they're going to have surgery on Thursday. He lives in Ohio, so his oldest son's getting married in August, and he's still out of Dublin College, not the one at home.
Oh, my. What is his first name?
Jay.
He grew up right across the street. Yeah. Oh, my lands. Right here for Jay. Yes. Others. Yes, Heather.
My parents listen from Florida every week to this service.
Yes.
Dad has some new health concerns that may take a long time to take care of. So I'm not used to him not being able to go.
Yeah.
Please pray for him to feel
What is your daddy's first name?
Willie.
Willie. Okay, we're going to pray for him, Heather, very much. Thank you. Other joys are concerned. Yes, Henry.
We should be grateful for all our visitors that are here.
Yeah. Absolutely. We're just thankful everybody's here, visitors as well. Thank you. God bless you. Yes, Ricky.
Healing for our country and all the hatred, the political hatred, that we can all come together and agree to disagree, and it just needs to stop. This is just insane. We need to come together as a country and as a people.
Yeah. So heal our country from all the violence, the hatred, and the rhetoric, and all that's going on at this time. Others, other joys or concerns. Certainly to pray for ourselves. Whatever we've brought in here today, if there's been any baggage, as I'll be talking about, to be able to check it at the door and leave it behind and be able to go out light and bright. So let us pray. O Lord God Almighty, thank you for caring so much for each one of us individually. If in our life is perfect, thank you for a life well lived. But if our life is anything less than perfect, please come to us this morning and heal us of any aches or pains that are emotional or spiritual. Some of us, when we are honest, confess that at times we can carry emotional and spiritual baggage from our past. Help us to identify any baggage and ask you to relieve and release us from it and live a life worthy of your calling. We know that as Christians we're not perfect. We haven't lived a perfect life. Help us to accept our past, live in the present, and look forward to the future with you. We know that Jesus said in John 10:10, I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly. If we've been living anything less than an abundant life, may we allow Jesus to heal us of that baggage that we have carried. When we come to communion rail, just as we are, and receive the presence of his healing through the sacrament, that he died to save us, that we have carried any baggage for too long, may we be able to leave this place this morning, checking it at the door and leaving it there to live a life that is free and light. For this we pray now in the Master's healer's name. Amen.
Christ our Lord invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, Lord. Amen. Now hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ,
you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward? Pray with me. Gracious and loving God, as we come before you today, giving thanks for all that we have in abundance, for all that you have given us, we ask that you let us open our hearts to freely give of our tithes, talents, and gifts, and that you take those and use them to build your church in your community through all people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now for our choral anthem, let us break bread together.
Let's be seated.
For our gospel lesson, is Aiden going to read to us this morning from the good news of the gospel?
Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things? They asked. Where's this wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't it this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, only in his hometown, among his relatives, in his own house, is a prophet without honor. He cannot do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith. Then Jesus went around teaching from village to village, calling the 12 to him. He sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, and no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave, as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Please be seated. And let us pray. Lord, we pray this morning as we study your word that you may speak to our hearts and our minds, the deepest, most part of our being. Help us, O Lord, to hear your word and internalize it and see the difference it makes in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, true story. George Buttrick, the great preacher and scholar, who was the editor of the 12-volume Interpreter's Bible, got up to preach one Sunday, and he said he felt like his sermon was about as flat as a pancake. When the service was over, he was standing at the door, and people were coming out, shaking his hand, but nobody said anything. Until finally one lady said, "Thank you for your sermon." And he said, "Oh, wasn't it a little long?" She smiled and said, "No, it just seemed that way." Well, hopefully my sermon won't be too long this morning. It may seem that way. And it's about take no baggage with you. Now, you know by baggage, I'm not talking about a suitcase. I'm talking about the kind of emotional, spiritual baggage that some of us can carry. Some go back to childhood, things that happened when we were children that some are still holding on to today. Some have happened as teenagers and may be holding on to right now. Some problems, some perplexities, some things that have happened in life. For some of us, it may be a teenager who was rejected in a romantic relationship. Later on, as an adult, we might call a divorce. Maybe some have been divorced, and others who had to get a divorce. I know my parents did. That was just a part of their life, of something they had to do to go on. So we live with that. But sometimes we carry that baggage with us and we don't let it go. We don't turn it loose. And this is where God comes into the picture this morning for us to be able to travel light, to let it go, to turn it loose. I asked my wife, Anita, this past week if I had permission to share this, and she said yes. I asked her, "Have you ever had any baggage to carry?" And she said, "Yes. There's been a hole in my heart from losing my father when I was 5 in a plane crash in Roswell, New Mexico." Now that's old stuff. That's been there a long time. But that hole in the heart is there. It's real. And some of you who recently lost a loved one know what we're talking about. It's like it leaves a hole in your heart. Some have said it's like part of me has died and we have to live with what's left. Well, all of us can carry that kind of baggage, and all of us can be aware of it. Sometimes it's the baggage of rejection. I know as a district superintendent, I experienced people that were rejected. Some of them were pastors, and some of them were parishioners. Pastors that were rejected by their church when the church decided it's time for a change. And I would try to minister to the pastor that this has always been the way it is. And of course, we have a staff pastor parish relations committee that helps us deal with pastoral changes. But a pastor can't help but feel rejected when that happens. But the same is true for the congregation. When the pastor decides to move, it's like the congregation experiences the hurt and pain of, "Well, that pastor we thought loved us, and now that pastor wants to leave us." Rejection. It can be very real. And some people can live with that as a grudge, kind of like a nagging memory of something that happened in the past, and it's time to move on, to be able to get over that baggage and that rejection. One that experienced it was right here in our gospel lesson this morning. Here is Jesus. He'd been healing and preaching and teaching and doing miracles, and then he goes home, probably for some R&R. And he gets there, and on the Sabbath day, he gets up to teach in church in the synagogue, kind of like I'm doing this morning. And the people were amazed, and they said, "Where did this man get these things?" they asked. "What is this wisdom that's given him? Even he does miracles. Isn't this the carpenter? He's no rabbi. He's just a carpenter." Isn't this Mary's son? Notice it didn't say, isn't this Jesus bar Joseph? Isn't this Joseph's son? No, this was an insult. Isn't this Mary's son? And aren't his brothers and his sisters here? And they took offense at him. Who does he think he is? They must have thought he's too big for his britches. Jesus said, only in his own hometown, among his own relatives, in his own house, is a prophet without honor. And he couldn't do any miracles there except lay hands on a few sick people, heal them, and he was amazed at their lack of faith. He was amazed at their lack of faith. Imagine how Jesus must have felt, the Son of God, being rejected by his own creatures. Have you ever felt like that? Do you know that feeling of rejection? See, we can all carry baggage from the past that we need to let go here in church, to leave it behind. Look at Mary and Joseph, Jesus' parents. Mary and Joseph were in love. They wanted to get married. But Mary was pregnant, and Joseph knew it wasn't his child. And so Joseph had resolved to divorce her quietly. But thank God, an angel visited Mary, and Joseph had a dream, and they got together, and they had all these other brothers and sisters of Jesus. You see, life can go on. Life can go on when we deal with our baggage. Look at Jimmy Carter. Here's a man who is 99 years old, former president, lost the love of his life, Rosalind, last year, hole in his heart, and heard the news that he had an inoperable brain cancer and wasn't having a long time to live. But President Carter said, I was amazed at how easily I took that message. 99 years of investment in the Christian faith paid off. He said, it was as if I had not heard any bad news. He heard the news, but he had the faith to know life was going to go on. And for President Jimmy Carter, he's now in the 16th month of hospice care that was only supposed to last 6 to 15 months. What an attitude. But he's not afraid of death. He's dealing with it. He's moving on. There was a young Christian lady, married to a fine young Christian man. The only problem was she suffered from depression. And they finally decided to go see their pastor to find out why was she depressed in this fine relationship. And the pastor, after a while, asked him, well, why don't you go back in your memory, young lady, and tell me what are your first memories? She said, the first thing I can remember was my parents telling me that they never wanted to get married, but they had to because of me. Imagine that kind of memory. They never wanted to have any children, but they had me. Imagine that rejection. But needless to say, the pastor prayed and ministered with them and also said, you need to see a good psychiatrist and maybe even some medication to deal with the hurt and the pain of that kind of rejection. My friends, I don't know what you may or may not have brought with you into the sanctuary this morning. Maybe you're free and easy and everything's fine and dandy. Maybe you've brought some rejection. Maybe you've got some baggage. Maybe there's something you could check at the communion rail this morning. That when you come down the aisle and receive the sacrament of healing, that you can leave it there. And when you rise and go, go lighter and brighter. Leave that baggage behind. Don't take it with you. Let us pray. Lord, we just pray this morning that if there are any of us who are carrying any baggage, whether it's been a hole in the heart or the loss of a loved one, or some hurt or pain or rejection in our life, we just pray, oh Lord, whatever it may be, you know what it is, And we just pray we can bring it with us, but that we can leave it at the communion rail when we come for the sacrament. For it is in Jesus' name that we may pray. Amen. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we pray as we prepare for the sacrament of Holy Communion that this will be a sacrament of healing, that we will go from this place different than we were when we came in. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, our service is on page 9 if you're in the hymnal. And we begin with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointing him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. As we always say, this is not the Methodist Supper, this is the Lord's Supper. It is for each and every one of you. The choir will come first, and then the ushers will show you the way if you would like to receive the sacrament of healing from God through Jesus Christ. Lord, if we come with any baggage this morning, may we simply leave it behind. If there's any hole in our heart, any memory of the past, may we move on now to the present and the future. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, we just pray this morning that this sacrament will make a difference as we internalize the juice and the bread, that we will internalize your presence and let it push out anything of our past that is not good for our life in the future. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lord, we are thankful that we have come, we have received, and now we can rise and go different than we were when we came. Thank you for your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord Jesus, thank you for this opportunity to receive this sacrament in remembrance that your body was broken and your blood was shed, that we might have life and have it abundantly. May we rise and go now and live that abundant life. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Oh, Lord, only you know what's been going on in our life, how much we need your presence. Thank you, O Lord, for being with us every day and every way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are there any others who would like to receive communion? Very good. Thank you, Roger. Let's all join together now as one body and one spirit. We pray our closing prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, our closing hymn is a hymn of invitation, Amazing Grace. And how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. So if you had any wretchedness in your life, let it be saved now as we sing this hymn. Let us stand as we sing. Linda, are you ready to join? Come on down. Linda's coming to us from another denomination. Yes. Therefore, I'm going to ask you this question.
Okay.
Will you be loyal to United Methodist Church and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service? God bless you and your witness.
Absolutely, I will.
All right. Well, we have an opportunity to respond to Linda.
Yeah, brothers and sisters, I commend to your love and care
Linda Carter, whom we this day receive into the membership of his congregation. Do all in your power to increase their faith, to confirm her faith, her hope, and protect her in love.
We rejoice to recognize you as a member of Christ's Holy Church and bid you welcome to this congregation of the United Methodist Church. With you, we renew our vows to uphold it by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ, that surrounded by steadfast love, you may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal. Sharon has been her neighbor and friend, and it takes one to bring one. So y'all take a hint.
Thank you for letting me have a new home here with you. I've been coming with Sharon for quite a while, intermittently. And you're right, it's the little church with the big heart, and that made me come back.
Yes.
So now I'm a member.
Yes. You bet you are. You know it.
Thank you.
Well, stay right here.
Where to go?
Don't go anywhere. We're going to pray, and if there's anybody today that needs to talk more about any baggage or hole in the heart or anything you want to talk about, Robert and I are here for you to pastor you through anything you're going through. So be sure and let us know. Now, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, may we go out now lighter and brighter than we were when we came in. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, now we can step to the side.